Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to our show. Here in our Hollywood studio, we have as a guest one of the outstanding personalities in all-time show business. You'll meet him in just a moment. Perhaps you can recognize him from this. Who is this? One of the great figures in show business. Well, we'll be back in just a second, and you'll meet him a little bit more in detail. But before we do, we'd like to have you join us, if you will, in our magic crystal ball right here.
Now, for those of you that would like to have a few days off and go where it's going to be very relaxing and someplace very wonderful for colds and sinus trouble and things of that kind, don't forget about Palm Springs and the Lone Palm Hotel, which is open all year round.
Right now is the most beautiful time of the year at the Lone Palm Hotel in Palm Springs. The weather is ideal, those tremendous crowds are gone, and you can enjoy the special reduced rates which are now in effect at the Lone Palm Hotel. There is no climate so highly recommended as that of Palm Springs to cure colds, sinus trouble, virus infection, rheumatism, or arthritis. With beautiful swimming pool, lovely kitchenettes, with brand new refrigerated cooling throughout all units, and the special reduced rates, you cannot beat the Lone Palm Hotel to satisfy your every need. Call Palm Springs 2241 immediately for your reservations.
All right, here we are, ready to go. Once again, I'll let you take a look at the photograph. It's our feature this evening. And as you look at it, we will also meet our guest of the evening. Right here, Horace Heidt. You're on, Horace.
Jack, that's a great start, isn't it?
How old do you figure you were in this picture?
Well, I don't know, but that bubble.
Yeah. Singing your first song,
my
I
first
imagine.
Song.
Forever Blowing Bubbles. Horace, you've had a great career, a long career in show business. Do you want to tell us a little bit about where you got started, that is, your early years, where you grew up and so forth?
Well, my first years were in Alameda, California.
Mm-hmm.
And then from Alameda, why, over to the University of California at Berkeley, then back to Culver.
I happen to know about Horace Heidt's athletic career. This is some years ago, when he was at Culver and later at the University of California,
right?
That's
right, Jack.
Horace, tell us what this first one is.
Well, that first picture, Jack, was taken at Culver back in Indiana. And that's when I was pitching for the school team.
That's Horace in the baseball uniform there with Culver written across his chest. And seems to me you had a no-hit game, didn't you? Something like that in those days?
At that particular time, I struck out 18 men in that game.
Is that so?
And that got me an offer from the White Sox.
You're going, might have gone with the big league
Might have gone
club.
With the big leagues, Jack.
White
Never
Sox.
Can tell.
You may yet. They're a little, they need pitchers this year, I understand. All right, and then you went up to California, and from California, got started in the band business. Is that right, with
That's
the Californians?
Right.
Anything in between there we ought to take
no,
out?
No, I don't think so, Jack. There was, we went to California, and we had five men and a dog. Lobo, remember?
Oh, yeah, Lobo.
And the dog used to draw the people in, and the band used to make the noise.
Yeah, that's right. And the dog was a big hit, wasn't he? How about this? Here's a photograph now of what I imagine is an early band, Horace. What about it?
Well, that picture, Jack, is about 1924. And I think it's interesting because it has people, see, that's almost 30, it is 30 years ago, and that's Virginia Mayo in the middle.
Oh, is it? Isn't
and
it?
That's Pansy the Horse. That's the act that that Andy Mayo, her husband, owns, and Andy's in the rear end of that horse. And if Andy's tuned in and wants to dispute that, let him come right down. He probably wants this picture. And then the dog there is Lobo the dog. So we had Pansy the horse and Lobo the dog, and that dog was supposed to be the finest trained dog in the world, Lobo.
I remember that. Let me see now. What have we got here, Horace? We're widening out a little bit for Paul, our cameraman.
In fact, that was our first time on radio. That was with Hugh Barrett Dobbs.
Mm-hmm.
And Dobbsy, as millions of people know Dobbsy, his programs were in the morning at 8 o'clock. And to me, Dobbsy was the greatest showman that we've ever had on radio.
Mm-hmm.
He was a wonderful man.
Let me now, before we continue with the photographs, Horace, ask you a little about this. Now, you're well known for having discovered a number of people, including Frankie Carl and Gordon McRae, so forth. What do you attribute that phase of your career to? How did it happen that you discovered these all these people?
Well, it's something, Jack, that I've always enjoyed very much.
There's no business like show business, like no business I know.
Now, tonight, we hope we have something interesting for you. We're going to show you some of the various people that have come from this organization. In other words, people that we've discovered in our travels and that are well on their way to stardom. So we turn the first page of our family album, and there is Gordon McRae. Perhaps a great many of you didn't know that Gordon McRae at one time was a page boy at NBC in New York City. We heard Gordon sing, we put him into our organization, and he did marvelously well, and of course now he's on his way to a great success. We feel the foremost artist of his particular type of work in the country today. Now the next page, there's Frankie Carl. Frankie Carl, the boy that we found in New Haven just about the time that he composed Sunrise Serenade. Frankie's a fine boy, has his own organization, wonderful chap, very successful, and I know you all enjoy his work. The next page shows Fred Lowry, our whistling star that we found down in Texas. Fred is doing well out on his own. We're very proud of Fred and the work and the artistry that he's bringing to the country. Now, Alvino Ray was playing the singing guitar up in San Francisco on a radio station. He was accompanied by just an organ. We asked Alvino Ray if he'd join our orchestra and incorporate the singing guitar as part of the band. He did. He was tremendously successful, and of course now he has his own band and doing exceedingly well. Now we come to arrangers. Here's a very fine boy that needs no introduction, Frank Duvall. Frank was with us for quite some years. He joined us in Canton. He's a wonderful chap, a wonderful arranger, has a fine ability, has his own band, as we mentioned, that is going, really going places. Along with our arranging staff, we had people like Buzz Adlin was with us, and Henry Russell was with us, Glenn Miller was with us for 2 years, also Harrison Carlisle, all top arrangers in America. The next page, Sherry Barabash, a girl that we found in Europe that we felt had one of the finest voices for her particular style of work. She joined the opera company in San Francisco and Los Angeles, and is presently in New York City. Then the next page is Pierce Knox. Pierce is a fine boy. Who will ever forget Pierce Knox with his wonderful work? Pierce is blind, as you know. Plays the xylophone, was our grand finals winner for quite some time. Next page, we have the Four King Sisters. They had a fine success. They're still having it. We found them in Salt Lake City. Four very lovely, beautiful girls. Al Hurt is next from New Orleans. You don't hear much about Al, but we feel he's one of the real great trumpet players of America, has his own orchestra, and doing exceedingly well. And the next is, of course, Ralph Sigwall, the boy that we found down in Charleston, South Carolina, which is really leading off to the 300 people that we're going to, that you will find here on this program. So we do hope that you'll keep tuned in each week, and you'll meet these people, you'll help them out for in building and encouraging the young people of today, you're building the nation of tomorrow. Thank you.
Let me see. How about this photograph, Horace? This is an early one, I guess.
Well, that's the Drake Hotel in Chicago.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if you'd look very closely, you'd see Frankie Carl on the piano, Alvino Ray on the singing guitar, the King Sisters.
Mm-hmm.
And you'd see Jerry Bowen on trumpet, who's now doing very, very well. And you'd see Art Thorson on bass. And Art is still with me. That's 28 years.
Still with me.
A wonderful person.
Here's another discovery of Horace's that maybe you'll recognize, maybe you won't, ladies and gentlemen. I've given Paul a little trouble with that one. Who do you think that is, folks?
That would be something if they could guess that. They, you know, there's a person they see all the time, Jack.
Mm-hmm. Who is it, Horace?
That's Art Carney.
Oh, yeah.
Now, Art Carney was working in a soda fountain when we found him. And
that
particular case there was where he was doing impersonation of Roosevelt.
Oh, he used to do that.
He used to do impersonations for you. And he was with us for 6 years.
Well, now, here was a big phase of Horace's career in the radio business, right? Is that
true? That's right.
What's that?
That was a Pot of Gold.
Remember Pot of Gold? It was the number one show. It was the biggest rated show of all shows on the air, wasn't it?
That's right. Jack, it took 6 months, at least 6 months, to interest a sponsor in that show.
That went so big, as a matter of fact, they made a movie about it. Hmm?
That's right.
In 1941, Jimmy Roosevelt, son of President Franklin D. Roosevelt, produced the movie Pot of Gold, based upon a radio game show that was the first show to give money away to the radio listening audience.
Let's stop the clock. We've got a crime to fulfill.
kill tonight.
Take a look at this photograph and let Horace identify the people for you. I guess you can see them yourself.
Well, there's Paulette Goddard.
Mm-hmm.
And there's Jimmy Stewart playing the harmonica.
Oh, yeah.
And here's Frankie Carl over on the... I guess that's the left of the picture, isn't it?
It's you at the piano there. Yeah,
and in the background, I see most of Arthur Godfrey's orchestra. They've all stayed in New York.
Whatever happened to him? Okay. That was a movie that you see on television, no doubt. I've seen it a number of times. It's a good movie. I get a big kick out of it. Now, there are a lot of things about showmanship that people would be interested in hearing, I think, Horace, in relation to yourself. What do you think the most difficult part of it is in the relation to putting on a show over the years as you have?
Well, Jack, I can't quite follow that. You mean...
I don't quite get it myself, now that I think of it. One thing I would like to ask you, in relation to an orchestra leader, do you think the important part is the music or the showmanship, the musicianship?
Well, Jack, we've always gone after showmanship, and we've had many, many personalities, feeling that bands that have a style, it's very seldom that they last. Of course, there has been those that will live forever, like Guy Lombardo and Glenn Miller and those.
Mm-hmm.
So we used to feature personalities, and we used to, in that way, try to keep our organization going.
Your big latest operation, so to speak, is in relation to the American way.
The American way. In other words, from the pot of gold, we went to the original youth opportunity program.
Tonight, Horace Heidt presents his original youth opportunity program from the Hollywood Bowl in Hollywood, California. Sportsmanship and competition stimulate a youth's ambition. So on with the championship battle of the week. In the Hollywood Bowl, Hollywood, California, here's Horace for Philip Morris.
Gentlemen, thank you very much. It's grand being with you nice people. As a great many of you probably know, during the past 3 years, we've toured America in search of young people. We've auditioned over 200,000, the cream of the crop you're going to see on this program. Also, another feature we believe you'll be interested in is the fact that we are the first television show which has organized and set up its own traveling motion picture unit.
Oh, I'm packing my grill, and I'm leaving today, 'cause I'm taking a trip California way. I'm gonna settle down.
For next week, with our traveling television motion picture unit, we're on our way to Salt Lake City, which allows us to televise our shows a few weeks in advance of showing,
which allows us to tour into any section of the world searching for talent. We'll present our 2.5-hour concert next week in Tulsa, Oklahoma, Little Rock, Arkansas, Hope, Arkansas, Shreveport, Louisiana, Baton Rouge, and New Orleans. And I feel very confident in saying that if you tune in each week, every Monday night, that during the next year, we'll be able to take you practically around the world. Picture television unit, which is composed of 4 trucks and 20 automobiles. We've journeyed down
to West Virginia, where the Horace Heidt drama will be played tonight. The car now approaching the auditorium is a Horace Heidt car, and it contains this week's contestants, 6 champions, 6 talented youngsters. As they walk toward the stage door, they realize that this is the most important moment of their lives.
It is better to build boys than to mend men, and to prove that we practice what we preach, we thought it might be interesting if we showed you how the original Youth Opportunity Program was actually conducted. To show how 50 or 60 young boys and girls during the summer months when school is out receive their education in show business, how they're taught to become fine American citizens. All the boys and girls live with me at my home in San Fernando Valley in Los Angeles, California. A home, incidentally, I've worked all my life for, but a home made all the happier by these wonderful boys and girls. We stay in California approximately 5 months. The sunshine, the healthy climate of San Fernando Valley, the swimming pool, and good, solid food keep the boys and girls in top shape. The entire troop arises every morning at 8 o'clock. The boys and girls are required, of course, to keep up in their studies and are given excellent tutorship. In fact, they're required to take the exact examinations required in their schools at home. All this is handled by our own tutor, Miss Catherine Nicely. And on the road, a special school car is provided to carry the members still attending class. Expert dancing instruction is provided in the mornings from 9 to 12. And in the afternoon, they have singing lessons. The boys and girls are chaperoned by Mrs. Dorothy Shepherd, Miss Catherine Nicely, and Mrs. Lorraine Camerata, and yours truly. Oh yes, I almost forgot. All the kids get paid for doing this. And most of the money goes into savings accounts or is sent home to their parents. Yes, nice people discovering these great young artists and helping to guide their lives is a serious business.
But from the original Youth Opportunity Program to the American Way.
The American life is a wonderful life. The chances it can give. A chance to get what your father's right. A chance for freedom, and that's a fact. For brand new talent, you get into the act. What a wonderful way. The American way. What a wonderful way to live.
Mm-hmm. Because the youth of America, in finding these people who were janitors or who were shoeshine boys or girls that work behind the counters, they are the ones that exemplify the American way.
Mm-hmm.
Because through freedom of opportunity, as we have it in our nation, they could do anything that they would like to do. And we try to bring these points out in the American way.
I see. And you've shared the world with that story,
yes,
haven't
have.
You?
Naturally, I'm overcome with this tribute that my son has paid to me, and I don't know exactly what to say. But I do want to thank the people that have come here this evening to see Horace Jr. And I especially want to thank those that were in my organization that came to perform, because if in some small way I helped them start their career, it makes me doubly happy.